My name is Jillian Goward. I'm a professor of chemistry in the Department of Chemistry and Chemical Biology here at McMaster. I'm also a graduate of McMaster. I did my undergraduate here, finishing in 95 with a degree in chemistry. And in that undergraduate degree, I had an interesting professor who taught a solid-state chemistry course. And out of that course, I got interested in how solids can contribute to materials properties. And I went on from here to a graduate degree at the University of Waterloo. So my research group, we work on lithium batteries, and we work on lithium batteries that are about this size. The question I've been asked to answer for you is about electric vehicle batteries and why are they not smaller and lighter and already overtaking the commercial landscape for electric vehicles. And the answer is quite simply the trade-off between cost and weight of the battery, as well as cost and safety of the battery. There's been various stories in the news where lithium batteries get a bad rap because they have this tendency to catch fire. So the first thing to understand is why that happens. And the reason is that the components in a lithium battery, like this one, have to be put together in a glove box like this one, where we exclude all moisture and oxygen from the process. The reason that's important is that lithium is then in its most reactive form, whether it's lithium metal or another reagent like lithiated graphite in the cell. If there's any oxygen exposure or moisture exposure, the performance of the cell dies. So this makes a very challenging manufacturing issue for companies that want to produce these cells. It's not the same as an internal combustion engine where air is one of the reagents, so you don't have to exclude air in the manufacturing process. Essentially, the cell is made up of a whole series of layers of material where those materials are very, very reactive with each other. And that's what you're seeing when the cell catches fire. Essentially, there's a whole lot of energy packed into the cell, and we try and control how that energy flows by separating those electrodes from each other using a thin polymer membrane. If that membrane is punctured for any reason, or if water or moisture or oxygen are brought into the cell, then you can have what's called a runaway reaction, or the industry lingo is a thermal event, which otherwise would be known as a fire. And so the trade-off becomes, if I want to make this cell really safe, I should use a thicker membrane that separates the electrodes from each other. And I should use a thicker casing to enclose the cell and to capture any waste heat and to do things like this. The problem is that all of those things I can do to improve the safety also increase the weight of the cell. And so this is where the trade-off comes in. As we move forward with our alternative chemistries for the cathodes, those are not making substantive changes in the question of weight. And as we look at the question of safety, if we change the composition of the polymer separator, for example, by adding ceramic particles and various things that have been done in industry over the years, these can improve the safety of the device under normal operating conditions. But there's always a question of how does a cell perform if it's sitting in Arizona on a hot day, or if it's running over many, many cycles with large changes in the demand on the cell in terms of acceleration and deceleration. The load demands that you put on a cell for a cell phone or for a computer battery, they're quite constant loads, and they're also recharged at a very constant set of conditions. What's demanded for an electric vehicle is responsiveness to how a driver behaves on the road and a very fast charging opportunity that would be comparable to what happens at a gas station. So as researchers are working on these problems, they're not focused quite as much perhaps on the weight of the overall device, but on the consistency of performance from the materials that we have and of opportunities for cost savings if we choose cheaper transition metals or if we change the casings, if we change the cooling system. These are a bit of the engineering side of the question that there are lots of groups working on, but I wouldn't say we're at the bridge of a sort of quantum leap in terms of technology. We're more doing incremental changes to try and improve the customer experience. So lithium-ion batteries are trying to compete with the consumer experience of the internal combustion engine. That technology has 100 years of engineering behind it, and consumers know and trust that technology. The lithium-ion battery is much newer, and so there's a lot of hurdles in the chemistry that have to be evaluated before we'll get the same trust from the consumer.